Well, we're continuing, if you haven't figured out yet what we're looking at today, we're continuing our series on Can I Get a Witness? The Post-Resurrection Appearances of Jesus. Last week, we looked at Jesus appearing to the disciples in the upper room. This week, we're looking at the appearance to the two disciples walking on the road to Emmaus. Now, Emmaus, I'm not sure how well you can see that map. Emmaus is 7 miles. It's slightly northwest of Jerusalem. You can still go to Emmaus today, still walk the same walk that the disciples walked on, still go to the same town. It's still there. So far, still Easter Sunday, the first Easter Sunday. So far, Jesus, at this point, has already appeared to two people. He's appeared to Mary Magdalene and Simon Peter, and that's mentioned in verse 34. Now he appears to these two disciples on the road to Emmaus. But first, who are they? Who are these people? Who were the first disciples? Who were them? We don't know. We really don't know anything about them. We know one of them was named Cleopas, and that's about it. That's really all we know. However, the point is, Jesus appeared to two of his friends who didn't know he was alive, and in their pain and in their anguish, they didn't recognize him. It wasn't until they had their eyes opened that they realized it was Jesus who had met with them all along. And they weren't the only ones in their pain who had a problem recognizing Jesus. Mary Magdalene thought he was a gardener. The disciples in the upper room thought he was a ghost. Thomas wouldn't even concede the fact that Jesus might be alive. He said, I have to stick my fingers into his wounds before I'll even believe it. And these aren't the only people who have a hard time seeing Jesus in pain, because let's be honest, you and I do too. When we are in pain, it's hard to recognize Jesus' presence. We're more likely to cry out like Jesus himself did, my God, why have you forsaken me, when we're going through the rough times, than we are to say instead, thank you for being with me during the rough times, during the hard times, during everything I'm experiencing in my life right now. Because let's face it, sometimes life is hard and painful. But it's in those times, of pain and difficulty when we have the opportunity to do the most learning and growing. And that's when we have the greatest opportunity to encounter the risen Christ, to be a witness to his power and his presence in our lives, if we will just allow our eyes to be open. As we look at this encounter with Jesus, with these two disciples, we're going to be looking at three W's, three words that start with W, the walk, the word, and the witness. So first, the walk. These two on the road to Emmaus were taking a walk that everybody in this room has taken many times. Maybe some of you are there right now, a walk of discouragement, a walk of sadness, of disillusionment, lost hopes, broken dreams, stolen futures. Verse 17 captures it all. It says it perfectly. Verse 17 says they stood still, their faces were downcast. Why? Why was that the walk they had that night? Why sometimes do you and I go on that? I think there are three main reasons. The first reason is that their vision lacked a spiritual dimension. And since it lacked this, all they had left then was a human understanding of the events, trying to make things make sense from the human perspective. Listen again to how Cleopas characterized the death of Jesus without a divine viewpoint. Did you hear what he said? This is what he said. Cleopas said, he was a prophet, not he is the Messiah. Cleopas had given up on considering Jesus the Messiah and now just was looking at things from a human perspective. He goes on to say, the chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. All hope is gone. We're stuck. It's all over. He's dead. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. He failed to meet our expectations. He did not do what we wanted him to do. We ever do that? It's hard to see things from the spiritual dimension, that's true, especially when we're going through hard times, I understand that. Still, though, I think sometimes we do the same thing Cleopas did. When the going got tough, Cleopas removed God from the equation. When the going gets tough for us, we do the same things too, don't we? We tend to go from God has really blessed me to God has really abandoned me. Why is God allowing this walk to be happening in my life right now? Why am I experiencing all this? I, since God has abandoned me, since God isn't meeting my expectations, I now have to figure out how to fix this and what to do. The second reason they were walking this walk is because they have their own agenda of how things were supposed to go, and that agenda determined their expectations of Jesus. Now many, in fact, almost all of the followers of Jesus originally had the wrong idea about the Messiah. They were looking for someone to bring back the glory days of Israel under King David and King Solomon. They were looking for someone to make Israel rich and powerful again. Looking for someone to bring Israel to be the world power like she once was. But compared to the reality that was in front of them, still under Roman oppression, from all they knew, Jesus was dead, though there had been some reports, so it's confusing. For hopes, for glory, seemed to be utterly destroyed. And again, we do that too. We're not different. We mentioned before how some people approach the Christian faith with an idea of, once I'm a Christian, or because I'm a Christian, I shouldn't have any more problems in my life. My life shouldn't be difficult anymore. Really? Because that has never worked for me. If that works for you, can you let me in on the secret? Because I don't have that. That's not how life works. And let's be honest, okay? Let's get honest. How many of us have ever said, maybe not out loud, maybe we've not said the words, but we've had the attitude of, God, if you will do X, Y, Z for me, then I will do this for you. Now again, maybe we haven't said that, but that's been the attitude. If you will, or rather, I will do what you want me to do if you give me what I want. If you give me what I want, then I'll be happy. Then everything will be right with the world, and then I will do what you want me to do. Then I will live the way you want me to live. And then when our own agenda of what we want God to do, of what we tell God we want, when our own agenda, when our own expectations fail, because God doesn't answer to us. When our own expectations fail, we're left wondering what's going on. If Jesus is reliable, maybe there's something wrong with us. Finally, the third reason I believe they were walking this walk, and why some people today still walk this walk that they're walking, is that they failed to acknowledge the resurrection. Because if these two followers had acknowledged the resurrection, they would have never left Jerusalem. Or at the very least, they would have been walking to Jerusalem to see Jesus. If they had acknowledged the resurrection, they would have stayed there. Number one, that's what Jesus told his disciples to do, stay in Jerusalem. Number two, they would have been going to find him. They also, second, they would have understood. They would have seen the trials and the crucifixion and the burial of Jesus as fulfillment of all that he had promised, not as the end of their hopes. Because they did not acknowledge the resurrection, it had not made an impact on their lives. Do you acknowledge the resurrection? Do we acknowledge it? Do we understand the impact, power that it can have in our lives? So that's the walk. That's the first W word. That's the walk. The problem they had that morning and the walk, the problems, the issues that we sometimes have too, that's the walk. The second W is the word. What did Jesus do for these two disciples that he did, still does for us? What did he do for them? He called them fools. In the Greek, the word that Jesus used is anoitos. And this word, what it means is it describes an individual who sees things from a distorted perspective. It's someone who has not adopted the divine viewpoint we talked about. So the word. Jesus explained the divine viewpoint on his death. How did he do that? He went back to the word. He went back to scriptures. He went back to what we call the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, to show them that the Messiah had to suffer such things. He basically said, if we were to paraphrase and put it in today's language, he basically said, guys, I know you have Bibles at home. I know you've read them. I know you've heard all this. Why don't you believe what it says? You know why these disciples were downcast, discouraged, and depressed? You know why they didn't have the divine viewpoint? It can all be traced back to the fact they did not believe what was written in God's Word. They did not have a living faith that latched onto the truth of God's Word. They did not believe God's Word. They didn't understand the things of God's Word because they didn't believe, because they wouldn't latch on, because God's Word was not active and alive in their lives. And then Jesus, the living Word, shows up, comes to them in their walk. He came to them in their time of need, met with them, talked with them, and by the time their walk with Jesus was over, they were burning with hope. Is this the same thing you and I have today? What does God say to you and me today in His Word? I'm going to make an assumption this morning. I'm going to assume that everyone in this room believes that in the resurrection, believes the resurrection has taken place, or you are at least willing to talk about it. You see that, okay, I'm willing to listen, I'm willing to hear. If you don't believe that, if that's not where you are, if you're one of these folks who say, I don't believe that happened, I'm going to be honest, I don't know why you're here. Why are you here? Why would you come back to this place every week where you would hear the same thing that you don't believe? So I'm going to assume that you all believe the resurrection took place, or again, that you're willing to discuss it one day. Okay, yeah, all right. So as one who believes in the resurrection, what does God's Word say to you as His child? It says, God says, I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. God's Word says to you, I will never leave you or forsake you. And remember this one from last week. God's Word says to you, I have carved your names into the palms of my hands. The same God who spoke all the words that created all there is, is the same God who still speaks to us today. Now, again, let's get honest. Let's be brutally honest. How many of us have lived apart from God's Word and then wondered why we're on the walk we're on? How many times have we cried out to God, wondering where God is, while His Word sits on a bookshelf collecting dust? How many of you right now can tell me where your Bible is in your home? And what the last thing you read was, and when you read it. And then we wonder why we're on the walk we're on. We need to know the Word of God. Ignorance of the Bible comes from ignoring the Bible. And ignoring the Bible puts us on the same walk that these two people were on and are reading this morning to Emmaus. People who do not see clearly. People who have a distorted perspective. People who Jesus calls foolish. Back to these disciples. So what happens? In keeping with Near Eastern hospitality, they invited Jesus to come in. He accepted their offer, yet he maintained his cover to complete the lesson that he began to teach them on the road. The lesson where he kept pointing them back to the Word, back to God's Word. He revealed his identity to them only after he had taken great pains to explain to them what was said in Scripture concerning himself. Jesus, through the Word, gave them a divine perspective on what they once saw as dismal circumstances, and once their eyes were opened to the reality and the implications of the resurrection, then Jesus became visible to them. The Greek phrase that gets translated, their eyes were opened and they recognized him, what that literally means is their eyes were completely open and they came to fully comprehend him. This was more than just a recognition of his physical features. This was more than them just saying, oh, it's Jesus. They came to recognize Jesus as the Messiah, as the Son of God, as the risen Lord, and they came to recognize and understand all that that meant for their lives, and it came only through an understanding of the Word. The Word. So then the final W, the witness. After these two disciples saw Jesus and recognized him, they ran 7 miles back to Jerusalem to tell the other disciples they had seen Jesus. They were witnesses of him being alive and well. Last week we said, if you are a Christian, by definition, that makes you a witness. Now, just a few minutes ago, we admitted life can be very hard. And in those hard times, we have the greatest opportunity to encounter the risen Jesus, to witness his power and his presence in his lives, in our lives. If we will just allow our eyes to be open. And opening our eyes, that's something we can't do on our own. The Holy Spirit needs to do that for us. How can we help? How can we make the process less difficult of opening our eyes? And the first thing to do is invite God in. Invite him in. Think back to our reading. Cleopas and his companions listened intently to the voice of truth, and then what did they do? They invited him in. They invited him into their home. They invited him into their lives. They said, stay with us. Invite him in. How do you invite God in? That's the next thing. Surrender our expectations. I know sometimes I can be a broken record. I know that. The Lord's Prayer. There's 4 words that we pray in the Lord's Prayer that we just buzz through, and sometimes I wonder if we really think about what we're saying. Thy will be done. Not my will. Thy will. Not my expectations. Not my agenda. Not what I want. But what you want. In my job. In my school. In my relationships, in my family, in my life, your will be done. Not mine. Yours. Third, we need to seek God's divine perspective. To help the disciples see their circumstances from God's divine perspective, Jesus explained the scriptures. And we have the same opportunity to understand God's vantage point by reading the only reliable truth we have, and that is the Bible. It is the only complete reliable source of truth we have because God wrote it, and God doesn't change. This doesn't have to be complicated. It really doesn't. Just set aside 10 or 15 minutes a day and read. Pick something. Gospel of Luke is a great place to start. So is the Gospel of John. Read 1 chapter of Proverbs a day. Whatever you do, do not start with the book of Revelations. But just pick something and read for 10 or 15 minutes a day. Get to know God's truth so you will not be, and I will not be, what Jesus called these disciples on the road to Emmaus. Anointos. Fools. Finally, and what may be the hardest thing for some, and I'm going to confess to you this morning I struggle with this, is to trust God's perfect timing. Sometimes I can be a very impatient person. Just ask my family. Ask my family, especially when I'm driving. I can sometimes be a very impatient person. But trust God's timing. God, in his perfect timing, again, look at the reading. He did not allow these two disciples to recognize Jesus. They were kept from recognizing Jesus until the time was right. He didn't allow them to suffer in their grief a moment longer than they needed to, but he didn't give them the answer right away. He didn't spiritually maturize them right away. He did not end their comfort too soon. Spiritual maturity rarely occurs instantaneously. Growth usually requires a journey, and journeys can take some time, so trust God. Go to his word. But trust God in his timing. He is faithful. Just like the two on the road to Emmaus, we do not travel alone. God is with us. We also have the company of other Christians who can come along beside us on the journey. Just make sure they are Christians, true Christians. A lot of people who call themselves Christians have no clue. Make sure they're true Christians that can come along beside us. Pray with us. We have the sacrament of communion. We receive the forgiveness of sins and the strengthening of faith. These are all at our disposal, but it starts with the word of God. So let's go to this God in prayer. Will you pray with me, please? Lord Jesus, thank you for coming to the two disciples on the road to Emmaus. Thank you for coming to them in their grief and pain and opening their eyes to fully see and understand you. Thank you for clearing their distorted vision. Jesus, we confess that we too have distorted visions at times. Forgive us for taking our eyes out of your word and putting them in the world. Forgive us for neglecting time with you in prayer and in worship. Forgive us for not surrounding ourselves with strong Christians who will pray with us, who will pray for us, and will hold us accountable is how we live in accordance to your word. Jesus, open our eyes. Let us see clearly like the two disciples in our reading this morning, but stir in us, Holy Spirit. Stir in us once again and ignite a fire and a passion in us. Make us to be the people you want us to be and ground us in your word. Place in us a hunger to know your word that is so powerful we cannot help but be driven to it. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus. And not only see him, but be completely changed by him. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.